love affair, Gwyneth Paltrow's the star of Possession. But as sports scene fans will know, Possession only gets you so far. Over to Jonathan.
This could be something quite sensational. What a goal! That is outstanding!
What a brilliant strike that is!
Oh, yes! Oh, it's unbelievable! Unbelievable! What a finish! The season of their dreams!
Welcome to Sports Scene. The World Cup campaign has been and gone. Gordon Strachan has been and gone. Tonight, it's back to the here and now. The Ladbrokes Premiership, where hope springs eternal. These two dare to dream as well. Those dreams cruelly dashed. Picking themselves up once again, though, Stephen Thompson and Michael Stewart. A growing sense of excitement about our top flight this season, reflected by a packed-out Easter Road for the match between Hibernian and Aberdeen. The Dons top of the table with Celtic, Hibs having shown they're more than a match for the top sides in the division. Commentary comes from Rob McLean.
This is the Hibs team which came close to ending Celtic's unbeaten run 2 weeks ago before the international break. Neil Lennon says same again. Aberdeen's Gary Mackay-Stephen makes his first league start since the middle of August. He replaces Greg Stewart. That's the only change from the team which beat St Johnstone 3-0. Graham Shinney, Ryan Christie, Adam Rooney, a hat-trick last time out, Christie's cross, and Gary Mackay-Stephen suddenly found himself with half a chance. The cutback from Christie came off Hanlon and into the side net from Mackay-Stephen. Well won by Arneson. McLean plays the 1-2 with Rooney. Good movement from Gary Mackay-Stephen. And a disappointing effort. Well set up here by McLean, but straight at Laidlaw. Neil Lennon's team started well. Good response from Aberdeen. John McGinn with the corner kick. Whittaker's header. And it was blocked by Kenny McLean. That's Ambrose. Whittaker again. And McGeoch. Back out wide for McGinn. Good control. But it's out of play off Logan. Hibs threatening from the set piece. Kenny McLean in the right place. McGinn at the centre of everything Hibs are doing. Nice touch from Whittaker. And it's Slivko. And that was close. The Lithuanian midfielder clipping the outside of the post. Excellent set-up work from Whittaker. The header from McKenna, down from McLean to O'Connor. Cary Arneson, Stevie May, Kenny McLean, and Gary Mackay-Stephen scores. He's been making front page headlines recently. He's back page news at Easter Road with the opening goal. 7 minutes before half-time, brilliantly carved out by Kenny McLean's pass. And that is a clinical finish. Gary Mackay-Stephen strikes for Aberdeen for only the second time. McLean with McGinn all over him. Great ball winning. A trademark John McGinn run. And now Anthony Stokes sees the glimmer of a chance. But he was falling over as he struck it. And the Stokes shot was always on the rise. Graham Shinney's throw, helped on by Adam Rooney. That's Ambrose. And John McGinn with a good strike right at the start of the second half. No second thoughts here. Joe Lewis was always going to save it. but it was well hit by McGinn. Kept in by Martin Boyle. Scurrying in off the left side, and he's taken out by Logan. No yellow card, much to the annoyance of the Hibs fans, but it's certainly a set-piece chance for the home team. Anthony Stokes with the effort, trying to catch out Joe Lewis. Now it's McGinn. No way through for John McGinn. Back for McGeoch. That's Whittaker. And Stokes loses out to Shinney. Comfortable save for Lewis. On from Bartley. Hooked away by O'Connor. McGinn loses out to Gary Mackay-Stephen. And it's the winger back on the ball and really turning on the style. Does well to keep that alive for Rooney. Well, the Aberdeen fans behind that goal were getting excited when this was in the air. It was a great attempt by Adam Rooney, and that was well kept in by Gary Mackay-Stephen. McGinn, desperate to level things up. Stevenson and Stokes, clever ball from Anthony Stokes. Martin Boyle just couldn't get there in time. Into a great area, this from Stokes. No joy for Hibs. That's won by O'Connor. Dominic Ball loses out. McGinn flighted over the head of Shinney for Martin Boyle. Big chance. And Scott McKenna blocks the shot in front of goalkeeper Joe Lewis. But it was in truth a team effort. And it maybe sums up Hibs in attack today. Lots of possession around the box, not enough shots on target. McGinn's corner kick, and Hanlon sees his header slip wide, claiming a deflection. But this was a chance for Hanlon. Aberdeen looking to hang on to what they've got here. A 1-0 advantage. Brandon Barker, the substitute. Danny Swanson, quick feet, good skill. And what a block. The red shirts were flying in to get in the way of that from Swanson. Stevenson's cross. And Aberdeen get it clear. This was a serious threat on goal from Swanson. And just look at those players in the way. McGeoch and McGinn. Hibs throwing everything at their search for an equaliser. There's another block, this time Christie. Swanson looks to work the 1-2 and does. It's Danny Swanson! It's a great save from Joe Lewis. Down went that left hand to get in the way of this from Swanson.
I need more from the forward players at the minute. You know, McGinn got two at Celtic Park. Paul got the winner at Ross County. So that's, you know, three or four games now we're going without scoring from forward areas, so that needs to be addressed. But we are playing well. You know, I can't, over the piece, you know, the level of performance was very, very good. Probably the best we've played at home for a while.
I thought Hibs were very good up until that final third, and we managed to keep their attacking threat quite quiet. And I think, you know, because of the quality of the goal, it separated the teams, and I thought we brought that quality to win the game, which is really pleasing, and really pleasing for Gary in particular, you know, because it's been very stop-start for him since he came, and he played the way he's been training, I said to you prior to the game, and his performance was excellent.
His determination just really showed what I can do, and today was a big game for us as a club, and you know, we wanted to come down here and set a marker, get the 3 points, and we've done that. So yeah, personally satisfied, but satisfied for the team as well. I felt everyone played well today.
A final way victory for Aberdeen. They remain unbeaten in the Premiership this season. Michael Stewart enjoyed a day out at Easter Road yesterday. Michael, A moment of magic, the decisive moment in this one.
Yeah, I think that a fair assessment from the managers there. This is a wonderful pass from Carrie Anderson. He could easily play into Kenny McLean, but he hits Stevie May and he takes those three midfielders out the game. Paul Hanlon is in no man's land. He's either got to be up and affect the ball or drop in and stop the defence. And he leaves a huge gap between the left-back and Effie Ambrose, and Gary Mackay-Stephen exploits that very well. Great first touch and really composed finish. But it was a great goal from Aberdeen.
The pass from Kenny McLean. Fantastic. Yeah. The weight of the pass is just
great ball from Carrie Anderson, and as Tomo says, that weight of the pass from Kenny McLean. It was the real moment of class in the game, and you heard Derek McInnes there saying it. That's what separated the two sides.
And Aberdeen stay top of the table on points with Celtic. Of course, Hibs, plenty of attempts, not too many on target. How much of a problem is that in the final third? For Hibernian.
Well, they had a lot of good play. You heard Neil Lennon saying there, they played really well. But when you watch this build up, there's Anthony Stokes collecting the ball. Look at the gap of support. There's six Aberdeen players round them, not a single Hibs player. And when he gets it here, no players in the box. Mm. He plays a really clever ball here in behind Shea Logan. But that's the best they could hope for. They get a corner out of it. Really difficult to get anything else from here. This was a really nice build-up. There had been three or four passes before it. Nice 1-2. When he gets to this point, he needs to slip in Martin Boyle, and then he could get in and go. Unfortunately, he doesn't lift his head, and he takes a couple of extra touches, and it breaks down. Again, that final third, just lacking that bit of class that Aberdeen had shown in the game and the goal. At this moment, Martin Boyle has got to go and attack that gap between the full-back and the centre-half. Instead of coming in, he's got to go direct. He comes in field and then he turns away. He loses the momentum out of the attack. Aberdeen are able to get plenty bodies back. And at this moment, it's slow, it's pedantic. There's not any real drive in it. And then at this moment, John McGinn recognises they've got to get some penetration. And that's it there. But look, Slivka, the only player in the box for Hibs, and it peters out to nothing. This was in the second half. Same sort of thing. Nice build-up. They work it from side to side. They're trying to probe the defence. At this point, Stevie Whittaker could maybe throw it in the box, but there's nobody there. Again, they come out into the middle to try and go out the other side. There's a bit of penetration there from the pass, and they work it. They've got that overload. Paul Hanlon just has to pick the right pass with Martin Boyle here. If he does it, he can take one touch and take the defender out of the game. He overhits the pass.
Sure.
Poor quality in the final third.
As you were saying earlier, Stephen, in terms of Hibs, a lot of rave reviews about them this season, but they're not really racking up the wins, are they?
Well, they aren't. And as much as though it feels as though they're playing well, they've won one of the last seven league games. And at Easter Road, they've only taken 1 point from their last three. And Easter Road was such a, they were so strong there last season. And it annoyed Neil Lennon that they're not getting the points on the board that maybe their performances deserve.
I think we're still getting over the World Cup dream ending, I think it's fair to say. John McGinn was part of the squad, wasn't part of the starting 11, Michael. When this new era begins, does he become a driving force in terms of the national team in the starting 11?
Yeah, well, I mean, there was a big debate. He should have been playing during the week for Scotland as well. And, this is just a couple of clips. Quick thinking play from John McGinn. It's a wonderful crossfield ball, a fantastic touch from Stephen Whittaker, and this is probably as close as they got. Slivka hits the post here, but great play from Hibs and John McGinn in particular. And these couple of clips here are the reason why John McGinn should have been playing for Scotland during the week. Look, he picks the ball up, he's back to goal, he turns, he drives, he's taken four Aberdeen players out the game, and he gets a booking off Graham Shinnie, because at this instant here is right after he's been booked as well. He clatters into Kenny McLean, he wins the ball, he drives. They've got a 4v4 now. And this is one of the things we were talking about before, lacking numbers up on the edge, in the box and in the attack for Hibs. That's what John McGinn brings to the side.
We need to give Aberdeen enormous credit here. It's been an outstanding start to the season. 10 days' time, they face Celtic at Pittodrie. It's going to be a massive match, a huge test. And how well placed, Stephen, are they right now to do something in that game?
Yeah, I think they'll be confident. You look how close they took them in the cup final at the end of last season. They look so solid all over the pitch for me.
Better since then?
Yeah, and I think they've got a lot of belief about them as well. That was a big, big win yesterday against a really strong Hibernian
side. I'm not sure that I would say that they're stronger than that cup final. I think that was a fantastic performance. And I think they're different.
Yeah.
Derek McInnes is still clearly trying to find his best formation, but he's winning games and he's undefeated. It's a fantastic run to be on while you're still trying to find your best form and your best formation.
Yeah. I was pleased for Gary Mackay-Stephen yesterday as well to get on the score sheet,
Okay. Well, next to Celtic Park, the champions with a massive Champions League match away to Bayern Munich coming up this Wednesday. First up, the visit of Neil McCann's Dundee.
Brendan Rodgers quite clearly has one eye on Bayern Munich and that Champions League trip to Bavaria in midweek. There are starts for De Vries in goal, Gamboa, Beaton and Kouassi for much-changed Celtic. After a lengthy layoff, which included a switch from Cali Thistle, Scottish Cup winner Josh Meekings finally debuts for Dundee, who haven't beaten Celtic since 2001. 31 games without a win against Celtic now for Dundee. Was knocked out of the League Cup, the quarter-final stage by them as well. Semi coming up for Celtic next weekend. Scott Sinclair across, and Bain gets a touch onto it because he's not sure where it's going. Olivier Chan spreading it to Roberts. I'm going to torment Kevin Holt here. Emerged through three challenges, still with possession. He's relatively comfortable in the end up for Scott Bain in the Dundee goal. He's looked lively, Patrick Roberts, so far. Still the pressure flowing towards the east end of Parkhead. This is Kieran Tierney. Well, we've seen him score from that kind of distance. We've seen him score from a lot further out as well. Celtic looking to make it 59 domestic games without a defeat. And this one, Griffiths, brought down by OD. Nothing doing, though. Roberts, McGregor! He thinks he should have scored. He got the two against Hibs a couple of weeks ago, last time out. Still wasn't good enough for a Scotland appearance, though.
Then you're always going to give yourself an opportunity of winning games.
Of course, they're going to have to raise the game up against Bayern Munich. They will have key players back, Stephen, like Scott Brown, Stuart Armstrong. How realistic are their chances over there, do you feel?
I think they'll fancy themselves to go and get a result. You know, it's a big step up from the Anderlecht game, which for me was the most important game in this group. To get that win away at Anderlecht, this one's a bit of a freebie, in my opinion. They can go and relax, try and enjoy it. What they don't want to do is get turned over again like they did against PSG, so I think they'll be possibly a bit better defensively or set up to be a bit more defensive.
OK, this week Kilmarnock appointed Steve Clarke as their new manager to replace Lee McCulloch. The former West Bromwich Albion manager and former assistant at Chelsea to Jose Mourinho was in the stands to watch his new side take on fellow Premiership strugglers Partick Thistle.
Alan Archibald recalls Chris Doolan and Chris Erskine for Turnbull and Lawless as Partick Thistle continue to look for their first victory of the season. As for Kilmarnock, their interim manager brings in Broadfoot, Power, McKenzie and Boyd for Hawkshaw, Waters, Thomas and Irwin. Kilmarnock also looking for their first win of the league season as Jordan Jones attacks down the left-hand side, he's away from Nitrianski, he's done well, has Jones, first shot, saved by the keeper, and I think that second effort might have nicked the post. And let off for Partick Thistle, Jordan Jones always looking lively, trying to catch out Cherney there, just takes a glance off the post. Paul McDonald in for one game before that man, Steve Clarke, takes charge. Very interesting appointment for Kilmarnock. Ambitious. Can Kilmarnock impress their new gaffer? Here's Frizzell looking to do just that. There's Rory McKenzie. That's a decent effort, but it just loops onto the roof of the net. But Kilmarnock looking the livelier side in the opening exchanges. McDonald's long throw, Jordan Jones just helps it into the box. Oh, Niall Keown hasn't dealt with it at all well. And Chris Boyd, poacher extraordinaire, turns the ball into the net. Well, there's one thing you don't want to do if you're a defender, it's present Chris Boyd with a chance like this, side-footing it into the net. And Kilmarnock deserving of their breakthrough. Thistle looking to respond at the start of this second half. Blair Spittle has been more or less their best player all season. Breaks for Paul McGinn. That's a good effort from the fullback, Jamie McDonald, pushing it away. Comes back in for Barton. And no Thistle player there. And McDonald able to gather. But Paul McGinn, really for the first time in the match, testing Jamie McDonald. McKenzie, overlap from O'Donnell. That's a neat ball from McKenzie. O'Donnell does well to get the cross in. Frizzell's there. Just couldn't direct it on target. Couple of Thistle players around him just to deny him the time and space to get this one on goal. And Archibald can't be happy with the way this match is going. His side have been unlucky on occasions this season so far, but this afternoon they really haven't been at the races. And here's Jordan Jones leading another Kilmarnock counter-attack. What a chance this is. Rory McKenzie now just lets it go a bit wide. Still the chance might be on for Kelly. Jones back to McKenzie once more. Here's Boyd. Nitriansky with the clearance as Kilmarnock press for what might be a killer second goal. McKenzie might feel he should have done better with that opportunity. Eventually he created one for Boyd. McDonald sends it way over the halfway line. Breaks for Frizzell. No challenge on him. Invited to shoot and he takes it. What a beautiful goal from Aaron Frizzell. His first of the season. And they don't come much better than that. And what a way to impress the new manager. Aaron Frizzell potentially wrapping up the points for Kilmarnock. Here come Kelly once more. It's Rory McKenzie. Infield for Boyd. Good strike, Jordan Jones. Oh, he's offside. The flag went up instantly as Boyd struck this. Jones just off. And Steve Clark must wonder how Kilmarnock find themselves in the position they do down at the foot of the table. Thistle now just looking for a consolation. Their winless run will continue. That is a fine effort and a really good save. Doolan bringing the best out of Jamie McDonald. It's a lovely touch here from Doolan to kill it. Good strike. And McDonald getting a crucial hand to it. Salmon there. Denied by the woodwork, but it's far too late for Thistle to be applying this kind of pressure to get anything from the game.
Bitterly disappointed. The first goal is always going to be vital in the game, and Kilmarnock got that, and it made it really difficult for us. We had a lot of possession, but we weren't penetrative enough. We didn't get in behind them enough to cause them enough problems, and it allowed Kilmarnock to play in the counter and deserve their win.
It's always nice to win, so I'm quite happy now that the game's out the way, that the new manager's in place, and I can go back to the shadows again of the academy.
A fantastic away victory for Kilmarnock. Worrying times, though, for Partick Thistle. Academy boss Paul McDonald in charge for that match, but a big presence in the stands. Steve Clark, the new Kilmarnock manager, Stephen. And that'll give him the players an edge, won't it?
There's no doubt. The presence of Steve Clark in the stand would have made them up their games, knowing that he was just there. For me, it's a massive coup for Kilmarnock to get a coach with his pedigree. Liverpool, Chelsea, Aston Villa, phenomenal.
Absolutely. As Stephen says, it is a big name appointment. Michael, and you know, something that will really hearten the fans, you would have thought.
No question about it. It's a real ambitious one from Kilmarnock, and the club have got to be applauded to be able to get somebody of that stature in. And I'm thinking that he'll have been very heartened by, you know, the performance and the result yesterday, because that was a big turnaround from what they've been doing recently.
We'll hear from Steve Clark tomorrow. In terms of the players on display, I think Jordan Jones has impressed us a lot. He's in the Northern Ireland squad now. A really interesting role yesterday.
Yeah, well, he had a free role. I mean, this one out in the more traditional left-hand side, skinning the fullback and driving into the box. He gets the strike off and he could have done better and found the net at that
this
point.
This is why Partick are bottom of the league. Look at them switching off here from a throw-in. So simple. Switching off and he gets in behind and puts an all right ball into the box that should have been dealt with, put it away for a corner. Why he heads it back the way, I've no idea. It's a really nice finish by Chris Boyd. to tuck it away. But Jones, you know, he was the difference yesterday.
And I think that you know, giving him that free roll, it means that he can drive, you know, off the line in behind the Chris Boyd yesterday as well, and they get another opportunity to strike. He's somebody that I'm pretty sure Steve Clarke is going to look at as a main for stay in the side, and somebody that's going to create a lot. Again, look, driving at the heart of defence. You heard Alan Archibald talking about not getting any penetration in the game. Jones is somebody that creates a lot of penetration for Kilmarnock when he's on his game, and I think for me he's one of the, you know, the best players at that in the league. Yeah, you know, whether he's out in the wide areas or whether he's in behind the striker, he drives straight at the heart of defences and he causes lots
so
of problems.
Fast as well.
How much pressure is Alan Archibald under at Partick Thistle? It's 9 games now in the Premiership, still no victory at the bottom of the table.
I think he is under pressure, but I hope the board give him the time to turn it around. You know, after the highs of the last season, it's sad to see Partick. We're now detached at the bottom, pretty much devoid of any confidence. They've lost their last 2 games, conceding 5 goals and scoring none in the last 2 games.
I haven't seen a lot of Partick Thistle. I thought, no, not any real, you know, problems and nothing
yeah,
to worry about.
Yeah, I'm thinking the same, but the longer it goes,
there's a bit of a concern. Although I think they are a club that are going to show some loyalty.
OK. Next, Hamilton struggling, Motherwell flying. Who would come out on top in the Lanarkshire derby?
Hamilton keeper Ryan Fulton makes his league debut in place of Darren Jameson. McKinnon, Donati and Biabi replace Crawford, Redmond and Longridge. Stephen Robinson keeps change to a minimum with his on-form Motherwell team. Andy Rose is recalled and Craig Tanner drops out. Chris Cadden with the throw, Ryan Bowman. That's Louis Mulch for Andy Rose, missed it completely, and Tate sees his shot tipped around the post by Fulton. Motherwell create their first serious opening. Cadden's corner, and the header comes off the post. It was Carl McHugh. The closest thing so far to a derby breakthrough. Cadden's throw. Up went Moult, away by McMahon. That's Campbell and Cadden. McHugh's cross. Down went Moult, and he's screaming for a penalty. It was Gogic who was grappling with Motherwell's number 9. Massimo Donati picks out Rakesh Bingham. Support arriving from Skondras. Headed away by Kipre. Dougie Emery looks to keep this alive for Hamilton. It's Skondras! It's a brilliant strike! And Hamilton are ahead on Derby Day at the Super Seal Stadium. The sweetest strike you'll ever see from Skondras. McKinnon, lead off by Biabi. And now Doherty looks to make something happen. Rakesh Bingham with the shot, and it's beaten away by Carson. A save he would certainly expect to make. Bingham should have done better. But Martin Canning's Hamilton still a goal up. In from Cadden, there's Bowman. And he'll see that as a decent chance to make it 2-0, Ryan Bowman. Carl McHugh, the captain. This is Richard Tate. Disguising the pass, Skondras miscues, and Andy Rose equalises. Well, he scored a spectacular opener, but he's the guilty party here for Hamilton as he sets up Rose for the chance to rifle in this right footer for 1-1. Biabi's header, away by Dunn. That's McHugh, in goes Skondras. Flicked on by Doherty. It's Rakesh Bingham, and it's a good hit. But Trevor Carson saw it all the way and clawed it round the post. Cadden against McKinnon. In goes Imrie. Now Campbell bundled over. Well, I think officially that is a stramash. And it's a free kick for Motherwell after that pile-up. Chris Cadden to deliver. There's Hartley! And Motherwell in front. Peter Hartley scores his third goal for the club. It wasn't great defending from Hamilton, but what a finish. That's Biabi looking to wriggle his way clear, and he wants a penalty for that. Tangling with a couple of Motherwell defenders, he was holding the shirt of Hartley initially before he hit the deck. Elliot Freer with the corner kick for Motherwell. What a saving header that is from Danny Redmond. It was goal bound from Carl McHugh. Up popped little Redmond to deflect it onto the bar. Redmond. This is Rojano, the substitute. Deflected, and it fell for Boyd, but it was behind him. And McHugh made an important challenge there as well. Elliot Freer combining with Biganimana. Can Motherwell score again? It's Freer. Oh, what a chance for Bowman! Well, he could have super sealed it there. It stays at 2-1. Bad miss. Hamilton chasing an equaliser. And it's Greg Docherty. Disappointed with that effort. Had to be going across the goalkeeper. And it's 2-1 Motherwell.
The boys are putting a lot in. They're working away, obviously, and we're a depleted squad as well. And it's just frustrating today because that's an opportunity for us to go and take points. And again, we've managed to find a way not to take points.
This is a difficult, difficult place to come to the surface. I've said it before, levels everything out. There's not a lot of football ever gets played here. But I thought we fought. When you go 1-0 down with our boys, you know they're not going to give up. They're going to keep doing the same things. And they've done the simple things well.
A good week for Motherwell. That's them up to fourth in the table. And manager Stephen Robinson as well, signing a new contract, keeps them at the club until 2020. And Stephen, clearly, set pieces are part of his coaching manual.
Yeah, it's clearly something they work on. They've scored more than any other team in the league with six. And yesterday, they were really impressive from set plays. If you look here, they've got six in the box. Normally, you might have a man ringing the box. They've only one, you might have two. In-swinger here, and you see it just causes absolute mayhem. Hamilton have actually marked up reasonably well, but it's just the strength that gets the header off the base of the post. And that was an early warning shot. If you see the next one here again, it's an in-swinger, but it's different runs. And because of the amount of bodies in there, it causes panic. There's nobody on the goalkeeper on this occasion, and that's a free header off the top of the bar. So that's him hit the woodwork twice. And in this one here, if you look, they've got seven players in the box. And, you know, it's risk and reward. If you put the players in and you're willing to take that risk and gamble, it'll pay off. You have played under managers that are really worried when you have a set player or corner about, you know, being counter-attacked rather than trying to score the goal yourself.
And well, you look at it, that's Motherwell, as Tom said, the top goal scorers in respect of goals from set play. So definitely it looks as if the risk that they're taking has definitely been rewarded.
As for Hamilton, a bad week for them. There's the whole fraud situation. They've lost significant funds this week. And in terms of this run that they're on, Stephen, I think it's their worst run since they returned to the top flight in terms of defeats.
Five consecutive defeats, and in that time they've lost 14 goals. I know. Consecutive defeats. And, you know, they've got 19 goals against in the league, and that's the worst of any team in the league. So
it's
struggling.
The day after your birthday, so we'll
it is, I know,
you,
I'm
Stephen.
Not feeling that
gentle.
Okay. Yes, a wee bit.
last three matches, Michael Hamilton taking the lead in those games and then gone on to lose them, and that is a very, very worrying sign.
Yeah, it's not a great trait to have, and I think when you look back to last season, when it was so often they took the lead in games and they were dropping points and getting draws, they're now getting it even worse. They're taking the lead and they're losing games. So they want to try and, you know, reverse that quickly because
they
we also
got a lot of injury problems.
I know.
Six big players out yesterday.
Yeah,
You've got some sympathy there.
Yeah, well, there's definitely sympathy there, but the problem is that you look at where Hamilton ended up at the end of last season, and when, as I said, they were drawing a lot of games, now they're losing those games, they're taking the lead, and that's not a great position to be in.
Well, to the Highlands next. Owen Coyle's first home match in charge of Ross County. Craig Levine's Hearts, the visitors.
Owen Coyle has the luxury of naming an unchanged side as he takes charge at home as Ross County manager for the first time as County look for the first home league win of the season. Injuries mean there's no Ross Callaghan or Aaron Hughes for Hearts. Don Cowie and Prince Barvin, who replaced Hughes in the defeat at Dundee, both start. The corner is deep, Davis can't get there, breaks for Van der Beek. Headed away by Suter. That's clear. Fraser comes through. Now's a chance for Jamie Walker. Lindsay tracks him back. Gonsalves available. Walker to Gonsalves. Gonsalves inside O'Brien. And Hearts have the opening goal. 34 minutes played. Corner at one end. Hearts rampage to the other. And Gonsalves slipped inside. It fell for him nicely. Walker did the work. Gonsalves with a finish. And Scott Fox with no chance. Ross County felt better, took Davis out. Referee Willie Collin not interested. Van der Beek. Ross County behind again at home. Van der Beek again. On to O'Brien. Nardine's calling for it. Jason Naismith available on the overlap. That's beautifully done by Gardine. Into the middle it goes. Randall doesn't clear. Keeler done. And almost instantly, Ross County are level. And it's a first senior goal for Davis Keelerdon. Gardine and Naismith combined. Brilliant first time ball. Randall failed to clear. And an easy finish in the end. It's a seventh Ross County appearance for Davis Keelerdon. And he has his side level with his first goal. Fraser from the back. Randall wanted offside. Keelerdon goes down. And referee Willie Collin, well, he gave him the benefit of the doubt earlier in the game. And that's what he's indicating. And doesn't give him the benefit of the doubt here. It's a yellow card. Free kick in by Garda. Curran with a header. He's so dangerous in the air. Craig Curran gets the little flick on. It's a decent stop by McLaughlin. Parts away through Suter. Connor Randall. Hearts got plenty of players coming forward. Gonsalves way. In advance of him is Lafferty. Lafferty tries to get away from Naismith and Fraser. Randall out wide. Jamie Walker with a chance. He's gone 18 games without a goal. Hearts top goal scorer from last season puts them ahead. Kyle Lafferty held up. Fraser had a chance to clear and didn't take it. Great pass from Connor Randall. And Jamie Walker, who's been desperate for a goal, 15 last term, gets off the mark this term with a really calm finish, driving it high and home. Randall against O'Brien, the referee, Willie Collum, didn't like it, and it's going to be a red card. Second yellow booked in the first half, and for the first time in his senior career, Connor Randall is off. First glance, it looked like an unnecessary challenge, and on second glance, it was. Craig Levine has been encouraging his side. The two young players, Ewan Henderson and Jamie Brandon, have done well. Here's Kyle Lafferty. Scott Fox with a save. Grislack chased it in. Fox well positioned, and it wasn't going to beat him. Hearts are getting used to playing away from home. This is the eighth away from home this season. They lead Schalke. Up against Smith. Brandon came off the shoulder, taken down by Keelerdon. McLaughlin with a save. Naismith tries to get there. Breaks from Mackay and off Jamie Walker. Well, it was a shout for a penalty, but the referee well positioned. Came off the top of the shoulder. O'Brien. Mackay available. Nicholson made the run. Mackay still going. They've sat off him. Little clip ball to the back post. Keelerdon! What a great chance that was. Well, he looks ruefully back at Billy Mackay. That was a great ball in. That should have gone on the left foot.
I think we've performed well today. I think we've scored a great goal, had great other chances to score some others. And listen, the referees are always charged with a difficult task, but I mean, we'd probably four or five great claims for penalties, two of them absolute stonewall penalties. So, of course, I think all that's went against us today. So frustrated, of course, because we certainly deserved to be taking points from the game, given what we offered to the match.
I was really pleased in lots of spells during the match where we passed the ball and looked quite assured, and then we'd take a little knock and our confidence would go, and we didn't quite continue that. And asked them at half-time, if you want to win the game, you need to play that way. So, and I was delighted that we not only started passing the ball well again, but at the same time had to contend with being down to 10 men for whatever it was.
A second win on the road for Hearts since Craig Levein returned to the dugout. A whole host of penalty shouts for Ross County, according to your old gaffer Owen Coyle, Stephen. Two stone wallers, apparently. We think these are those.
Yeah, but I think he's got a good case with this one. When you see the other angle, Christoph Berra isn't looking at the ball at all and just basically manhandles him to the ground, and the referee's in a really good position. I'm surprised that that wasn't flagged as a penalty kick. This one, again, he's doing similar, but it's not quite as ferocious as the first one.
No, I mean, that would have been soft, but he's running the risk because you see Curran's top getting lifted there. That's one of Christoph's bad habits. He holds on to players, he grabs shirts, yeah. And he's fortunate that he didn't give away at least one penalty there yesterday.
Would you concur with the birthday boy about the first one?
Oh, the first one for me is a penalty, yeah.
How do we sum up Hearts at the moment? Because under Craig Levein, I think it's two wins, two draws, one loss so far. They're not really getting the plaudits. Yeah. Do they deserve
well,
more?
Well, I wouldn't so much say the plaudits. But what I would say is when you compare it with Hibs, who have had a lot of positive things said about them, they're only 1 point behind them.
Yeah.
Hearts have got a lot of home games coming up now, so they're not in a really bad position. They're obviously in the bottom six. They want to be further up the table. But when you compare them with Hibs, there's only 1 point of difference between them, but I think the perception of the seasons is vastly different.
OK. Right, let's move on to the Friday night game. The lead-up to the St Johnstone Rangers match had been all about leaks, moles and accusations of paranoia and intoxicating mix. How would it manifest itself on the football field? Commentary comes from Paul Mitchell.
Two changes for St Johnstone from the loss at Pittodrie. Scott Tanser and Paul Payton find themselves on the bench. First league start of the season for Chris Miller. David Witherspoon also recalled. After two games out, Bruno Alves is fit again. He replaces Ross McCrory. Ryan Jack suspended, sent off last time out against Hamilton. So there's a starting berth for Jason Holt. Candias inside, strong tackle. Murray Davidson, McLean. Cummings on the chase. Alves tracking him back. He'll try and get the shot away. And does so, Graham Cummings. Yet to score this season. This is sixth start, been off the bench five times. Got plenty of power in it. Rangers building up. Holt under pressure. Play on, says the referee. Morales. Tavernier. That's a good delivery. It's an even better finish. Carlos Peña at the back post. That's what the Rangers boss thinks, and why not? It's a fine finish. The St Johnstone defence get themselves caught underneath the ball, and Painter reacts to pick out the top corner. All about the cross, and then all about the finish. Deep corner. Anderson goes up. Graham Cummings just drops over his shoulder. Yeah, he's annoyed, rightly so. Just needed to hook it, a bit more precision. Anderson. Cormick tries to go in with Windass. Morales is through. That's off the goalkeeper. Well, Morales was simply stronger than Murray Davidson. St Johnstone looking for a free kick. Might have been a little push in the back. Windass on Cormick. That was clever play by Morales. Rangers took 8 points from St Johnstone last season. Leading here, going again, Peña the goal scorer. Came close to a double. Just a couple of league goals in Mexico last season. Only got two league goals in Scotland this term. Unable to play tonight, Michael O'Halloran has to watch on. Corner cross, Shaughnessy. Shaughnessy got up really well. It was Alves in behind him. Glanced off the head of the Rangers defender, and it's yet another corner. Saints trailed Hamilton at home and came back to win, but there's problems here. Now Anderson and Alves were at the heart of it. Alves and Anderson are now in two separate groups. All sorts of pushing and pulling. No surprise, Morales gets in the middle of things. Alistair Ross is on. I think both these players will be in trouble. Referee Don Robertson. Well, you can see the two players centre picture just niggling away each other. And Anderson not happy. A little bump and then the pushing started. Yellow cards for both. Windows away. Morales gets away from Anderson. He's in trouble. It's a second yellow and it's a red card. A hand over the shoulder was enough for referee Don Robertson. And for the first time in over 3.5 years, Stephen Anderson is red carded. Not much of a touch, but there was contact. Holt. Tavernier. Set up the first goal. It's another decent cross! And it's another Rangers goal! The colour combination come together again. Tavernier the provider. Carlos Peña the finisher. And Rangers are 2-0 up. Look at the space Tavernier has. Lovely run to the back post, the defender's caught underneath, and Carlos Peña has a double. Well, it's going to be 3 points for Rangers as Declan Jones comes forward. Referee allows play to continue, and Diaz still has the ball. Morales, that's off into Dorans, one thing on his mind! Man is happy to see that crash off the bar. It's a cracking hit from Graham Dorans, seeking his fifth goal of the season. Rangers coming again, they want more. Morales. Morales went down, play on, says the referee. Holt inside, Dorans! That'll round it off for Rangers. It's the best performance of the season, little doubt about that. They've taken advantage of the fact that Johnston went down to 10 men. But they've been clinical, they could add a free kick, credit the referee to allow things to continue. Graham Doran certainly agreed with the decision. Rangers 3-0 up in Perth. And it's an impressive performance.
One nil the game with a sending off, it totally changes. And, you know, I probably wee bit the blame. We're going three at the back and trying to get back in the game and probably cost us this, you know, the second goal. But, you know, overall, I was happy with our performance. It was a good response from the Aberdeen performance, and ultimately it's a defeat, and it's one we've got to learn from.
Good win for Rangers. Best collective performance of the season, according to the Rangers manager, Pedro Caixinha, said the cherry on top of the cake, Stephen, was the clean sheet.
Yeah, absolutely. He talked about them wanting to defend better, go back to basics, and I thought they defended really well within the game. Here you'll see their shape, a narrow four with the two midfielders sitting in front of them. And one thing we've said about them in the past is not tracking runners. Look at Ken Diaz here. Tracks a runner and clears the danger. They had so many clearances in the game on Friday night. Bruno Alves was really commanding at centre-half. Here you see another one clearing it. In the game, St Johnstone had 16 corners, which is the most of any team in the league this season, but they dealt with them really well. This time it's Cardozo at the back post, clears the danger, and defensively as a unit all over the park, they were impressive.
We have to talk about the enigmatic Carlos Peña again. Two goals against St Johnston. Everybody seems to have an opinion about this player, but how impressed were you, Stephen, by his overall performance?
Well, it was his best performance in a Rangers jersey so far. He's been criticised, and rightly so, in my opinion, but he's doing what he should be doing, finding space in that number 10 role, plays it out wide and makes his way into the box. And he is a goal threat. You know, he will score goals. The quality of the cross that comes in is poor, which was a feature for both sides throughout the match in the final third until, of course, this moment from Tavernier. What a ball this is. They look OK, St Johnston set up here, but Morelis drifts in behind Shocknessy. He doesn't see him. And Anderson's forced to come over and try and compete with the header, leaving Peña free at the back post. And that's a difficult finish, and it's a good finish. The quality of this ball, again, is sensational. Anderson's off the pitch at this point in time, but you've still got to go and header it into the bottom corner.
There are two good finishes from Peña.
It's all about the ball.
But the crosses from Tavernier phenomenal. Are fantastic. And, you know, for Carlos Peña, I don't think he's performed particularly well, but if you're a goal-scoring midfielder and you're putting the ball in the back of the net, it's very much in the same vein as a striker. You know, people say, well, he's not doing a great deal. If he's putting the ball in the back of the net, then, you know, that's certainly going a long way to disproving a lot of the critics.
So four goals in eight games. Do you think some of the criticism on him has been too harsh?
No, I think he's not performed particularly well. Mm. What I'm saying is if he continues that goal-scoring form throughout the season, then, you know, he's going to be in a strong position for not just him or for the manager, but anybody that's been involved with the club to turn around and say, I think he's been a success. But at the moment, I think he still needs to up his game.
You've been impressed by Graham Dorans in the Rangers midfield. Do you think he should be on the cards for Scotland return?
he should certainly be on the radar. I thought he was sensational yesterday. We talked about the defending. Here he is doing a defensive role as a midfielder. That was another cleared header. There were so many of them in the match. Skugel, I thought, was excellent for St Johnstone. But here he takes up a really good position, clears the danger, no nonsense, taking no risks. This one I really like. He's organising, he's disciplined, he's telling Declan John to get back into his position, follow the run. He does that, albeit a bit late. Stephen McLean, nice wee turn. And look at him, he spots the danger. McLean's going to try and cut this back to Witherspoon at the edge of the box, and he gets into a really good area to snuff the danger out. That was defensively. In attacking sense, he was brilliant. His passing was superb. He's a goal threat. This is an incredible strike. Really unlucky, comes off the face of the bar.
It's difficult to hit that when it's coming across your body.
Across your body, absolutely. And he got his rewards with this goal. Look at this, this is late on in the match. The desire to make his way into the box. He's the second top scorer in Scottish football in the league just now with 5 goals. And I think his impact since he joined Rangers has been sensational. That's a brilliant first-time finish.
Great. Great.
Very quickly, we must talk about the Stephen Anderson sending off. Was it soft?
Yes.
Aye.
Let's have a look at question. It. Yeah. I mean, this is not a yellow card.
No idea why he get booked.
I mean, this is. I mean, a quiet word with both players there. But I mean, Bruno Alves is the one that, you know, does more in that incident. But all the referee needs to do is just have a quiet word. You know, there's no.
It's just not a booking.
No, never.
And you know, that was the first one, and it's disappointing. The second one for me, again, is soft. And I think he was unlucky to be sent off in the match. All right, he's naive to get the wrong side, but there isn't a lot of contact there. And for me, Morelos throws himself to the ground dramatically.
He does. I mean, that is, there's always going to be contact to some extent. Does he impede Morelos? I don't think he does. So I think he's very unfortunate to receive a second yellow for that and to get himself sent off.
St Johnstone were competitive up until that point in the game.
Yeah, 3 defeats in 4 matches now for St Johnstone. We have to leave it there. Stephen, Michael, thank you very much indeed. All that leaves Ladbrokes Premiership table looking a lot like this evening. Celtic and Aberdeen remain level on points. Celtic top courtesy of their superior goal difference. Rangers third, 6 points behind, and Motherwell move up to fourth ahead of St Johnstone. Partick Thistle, bottom of the pile on 3 points. And that's it for this evening, but if you like combustible action, join the three of us tomorrow lunchtime for a no-holds-barred edition of Sportscene Extra. That's at 1 o'clock on the BBC Sports Scotland Facebook page. For now, though, from all of us on the Sportscene team, it's good night.